left me. Thank you all for attending this workshop organized by me and my colleague Roland Polka on behalf of Transform Europe. So good. It's on.
It's on.
Yeah.
Isn't it?
Yes, it's on.
So, the discussion we propose to have this afternoon is about Airbnb, the largest short-term rental platform operating worldwide, the struggles against it, the challenges it poses, and alternatives. To do so, we are honored to have with us Kenneth Haar from the Corporate Observatory, who will talk about their work concerning how online rental platforms use EU to defeat cities' affordable housing measures, and more recent developments regarding what is going on in EU corridors. It is also a pleasure to have with us Kathleen, a member of the Regional Board in Parliament and responsible for housing policy in smart cities. Kathleen will address the Berlin experience on the regulation of short-term rentals from the perspective of the threat it represents to the right to housing. But you will also address a broader issue regarding how platform capitalism, Airbnb included, challenges data security and data security and data policies. Right. Last but not least, Stefania Animanto, a researcher and member of the research team PLUS, Platform Labor in Urban Spaces, who will provide us with a short overview on alternative projects and models that might cope with the challenges and the disruptions brought by Airbnb and similar about the case of Airbnb in the two biggest cities in Portugal, but also trying to frame it within the right to housing question. I hope I'm not too chaotic, but if I am, then you can ask me later for details or whatever. So, as you probably know, Portugal was recently subjected to a Troika memorandum that lasted until 2015 with the application of extremely harsh austerity policies. These policies had a tremendous effect in the Portuguese economy and society, and particularly on the attack that Portuguese cities have been suffering from Airbnb and other short-term rental platforms. So the right to housing in Portugal is a constitutional right. It's inscribed in our constitution that dates from 75. It has an article, which is the Article 65, where it's stated that it is the state's responsibility to ensure this right. Yet in Portugal, we have only 2% of public housing, and the social housing is mainly the responsibility of the local authorities, so it varies a lot between different cities. So, and for many years, the state was promoting the right to housing more in terms of giving benefits, whatever, in terms of the purchase of homes. In fact, until the years of the crisis, we hardly could mention a housing problem in Portugal. Part of the explanation comes from the fact that since 74 and until 1990, all tenancy agreements in Portugal were permanent, and the possibility of increasing the rentals values was only introduced in the 80s and within very, very strict limits. The bill that was passed in 1990 opened the possibility for fixed-term rental contracts, and it also aimed at updating the rental values, but still within limits. Again, in 2006, there was this new urban lease reform, which again aimed at updating these rentals from the permanent contracts, but still maintain the possibility of fixed term contracts. The minimum of years is 5 years. So in this scenario, and until 7 years ago, the Portuguese rental market was divided into categories. So the permanent rental contracts and the liberalized market, which was still refrained by the low rentals in the permanent contracts category. So this goes without saying that in Portugal we have a situation in which, due to the permanent rental contracts, private landlords were kind of ensuring the right to housing at affordable prices, so to speak. And this was exempting the state and local authorities from providing public and social housing. Yet in 2012, during the Troika years in Portugal, and due to an agreement between the neoliberal government and the Troika, a new urban lease reform was put in place, which simply abolished the permanent rental contracts. According to this bill, landlords became free to propose a rental increase to their tenants without any limit, and in the absence of an agreement, tenants would be evicted. So, and as you may know, Portugal is considered a privileged tourist destination due to its nice climate, low prices, and the fact that it's the fourth safest country in the world, or in Europe at least. So running the risk of being chauvinist, we do have beautiful cities in Portugal, and here you have Lisbon, picture of Lisbon in Porto. But from what I told you previously, and since 2012, Portugal has also become a paradise for short-term rental platforms to operate, giving a completely picture of these two cities. So this is taken from inside Airbnb. In red you have the full houses available for rent. In green it's private rooms, and in blue almost, we almost can't see, would be the shared rooms. Over these past 5 years, we have witnessed a brutal emptying of residents from the historical centers of the cities, particularly in Lisbon and Porto, to the detriment of the emergence of short-term rentals. Together with the lack of public and social housing in Portugal, you may understand the dramatic effect that this has been creating, affecting mainly lower-income people. Of course, this also then the decrease in the offer for rentals, permanent rental, this also leads to an increase in the global rental market, the prices in the global rental market. So let's look at the cases of Airbnb in Lisbon and Porto. So in the beginning of the year, I went through this AirDNA website, and I collected data from many different European cities for purpose of comparing and doing some research about it. But at that point in time, in Lisbon we have almost 15,000 active Airbnb rentals, and in Porto almost 70,000 active Airbnbs. These are numbers. The Lisbon number is similar to what we can find in Berlin, but the population in Lisbon is 1/7 of the population in Berlin. Porto, we may try to compare with Vienna, and the population of Porto is 1/9 of the population in Vienna. So I think it's easy to understand the impact that these Airbnbs are having in these two cities. So, but let's look into more detail on the data AirDNA provides, and we can see that yes, in terms of, I don't know if you can read the legend, but this is in grey entire homes, in pale blue private rooms, and in dark blue shared rooms. And we can see that in Porto, as well as in Lisbon, at more than 75% of the registered rentals are full houses, entire homes rentals. So, as well, we can see that, so this is the rental activity ordered by the periods active rentals are in the market or for rent, and we can see that Lisbon and Porto are the cities that have the lowest active rentals for the shortest periods of time. So up to 70% of the rentals are available for periods over than 3 months. So such a picture is a clear indication that Airbnb and most probably other short-term rental platforms are having a clear effect on the number of houses available for residents or for permanent rentals. Another interesting aspect that came out from this comparative analysis, so here we have the active rentals in Airbnb in terms of hosting, so single hosts and multi-hosts. And we can see that it is, again, in Lisbon and in Porto, where the properties registered by a single host are at its lowest levels. This is, for us, this is important because during the Troika years, in the beginning, when Airbnb started kicking in Portugal, we had high levels of unemployment and harsh cuts on people's incomes, and Airbnb was seen as a strategy for people to survive, so to speak. If this was the case back then, it's clearly not the case nowadays. So Airbnb in Portugal, most of the Airbnbs are held by corporations and not people, so to speak. So now, what about regulation in Portugal? There is not, so far we don't have had any regulation at all, and very slowly things are starting to move on, regulation regarding short-term rental platforms. So in 2017, for the first time, there was this introduction of a compulsory registration of all short-term rental units. This registration, the responsibility of the registration is done at the local level, but municipalities, they receive a call for issuing a license. They have 10 to 20 days to answer. If they don't answer, the unit is automatically registered. So this measure was put in place more in terms of fighting some tax evasion associated with these platforms rather than regulating the number of short-term rentals available. It was only in October last year that new legislation came into force, recognizing the social and housing problem that short-term lets have been introducing in Portuguese cities. Indeed, the preamble of this diploma reads, "With the goal of preserving the social reality of neighborhoods and places, the territorially competent city council can approve, by regulation and based on reasoned deliberation, the existence of areas of restriction for the installation of new short-term rental accommodations." So this law set a legal frame for municipal authorities to act. Essentially, it established that municipal authorities may create containment areas in situations where short-term rentals flourish and the housing market offer is failing. Such containment areas have to be subjected to municipal regulation, and also that tenants' assemblies can require the suspension of short-term rental licenses, because usually these units have huge impacts on buildings where people live in. So what has happened since this legislation came into force clearly mirrors the differences between the municipal governances in Lisbon and in Porto. So if in Lisbon we have a center-left mayor house, they immediately suspended the issuing of new licenses in the most affected areas of the city until the municipal regulation is approved. This regulation is now under public discussion and shall be voted in the very near future. This proposal has many things, but the most important one is that it forbids new licensings in areas where short-term rentals attain 20% or more, and those are defined as restriction areas, and creates containment areas where the ratio lies between 10 or 20%. The case of Porto. Porto has a liberal mayor house. They, since October, they refused to take any preventive measures as long as a scientific study regarding the reality of short-term rental accommodation in Porto, commissioned and paid by the mayor house, was published. So this only happened, the disclosure of this study only happened in the beginning of May. And although several areas were identified as having over 50% short-term rentals, the municipal authorities still refused to preventively suspend new licensings. I had this written, but now I have news. So the proposal of municipal regulation was supposed to be disclosed today, and it was indeed this morning. And we find out that their proposal is that in the areas where short-term rental accommodation are 50% or more, new licenses can be issued, but only for a two-year period, where in areas where it lies between 37.5 and 50%, new licenses can be issued only for 4 years. So, and we already knew that something not good was about to come, because last week, referring to this regulation proposal, the city council responsible for tourism, he stated to a newspaper saying, whoever wants to have a short-term rental accommodation has the right to do so, absolutely. And in the city of Porto, we will ensure that this right is protected. And further adding, we will put forward a good practice code elaborated in cooperation with Airbnb so that short-term rentals in the city of Porto may become of high quality. So it's not a good panorama, so to speak. So. And what about struggles, resistances, and advances? The truth is that over the past years, the right for housing movement in Portugal is becoming increasingly stronger and prominent. As mentioned before, in the current context, and as long as other legislative measures are not put, are not taken, and the law is still on the side of real estate agents and landlords when it comes to evictions and protecting the right to housing. As well, the attempts to regulate the short-term rentals are still very incipient, as I just told you. Yet, the movement for the right to housing in Portugal has managed to render visible the growing housing crisis in Portugal and has forced this issue into the political debate, both at the local and at the national level. And I would like to stress that last Friday, the first basic law on housing was approved at the national parliament by the left. This basic law establishes a broad legal framework defining the state's responsibilities and fundamental tasks in the effective guarantee of the right to housing for all citizens. Although this is, of course, an important step forward on the housing question, the effectiveness of such basic law is yet to be seen and is dependent on political will and future legislation. So, thank you.
I'm Kenneth Haar. I work with a group called Corporate Europe Observatory. We're a lobby watchdog based in Brussels. So we see it as our mission to keep track of what lobbyists, mainly lobbyists that work for big companies, for corporations, how they try to influence European legislation and decisions in the EU institutions. We've worked on many issues over the years, climate change, trade, agriculture, the financial sector, who knows what. We came to this particular issue because we were on a study tour to Barcelona a year and a half ago. And while being there, we heard loads of horror stories about how landlords tried to basically evict people from their apartments It could take the form of shutting off the gas supply or inflicting a rupture in the power supply. There are even stories about landlords introducing cockroaches to apartments to make sure that people were got so fed up with their apartment that they moved, so that the landlord could start renting out the apartment via Airbnb. I mean, obviously, this is because lots of money can be earned on renting out to tourists, a lot more than by renting out to long term to local citizens. Over the past year, there has been a kind of a pushback from many cities. We see more and more cities adopting actually more and more strict rules across Europe, and it takes different forms. We have in Barcelona, there are zones of the city where there's a moratorium on new licenses, so that there will be no more licenses for apartments to rent out via Airbnb or other platforms in the years to come, at least in the old part of Barcelona. In Amsterdam, there's a rule that people can only rent out, it's now decided, 30 days per year. And until recently, it was 60 days a couple of months ago, but now it's been reduced to 30 days. There's the case of Palma de Mallorca. That was last year. In Palma de Mallorca, there was really kind of a clampdown on Airbnb. They decided that all flats in blocks were barred from renting out via Airbnb. So thousands of apartments were taken off the Airbnb market in Palma de Mallorca. Clearly in response to what was going on in the local housing market. Rents have gone up by 40% over the past 50 years, and there has been some clear signs that the local population of Palma de Mallorca would not be able to stand that much longer. People were actually almost being evicted through market mechanisms in that fashion. There are different kinds of rules in Paris, and now there are many different models which all, I would say, correspond to the local situation. When we were in Barcelona, we were approached by a group of academics and a couple of people from local housing movements, and they asked us if we could look into whether Airbnb has launched some kind of lobbying offensive in the European Union, in the Brussels institutions, because clearly, I mean, what cities have been doing over the past years is to use the lingo of the European Union, they're restricting the delivery of a service. They are making it more difficult for a company, Airbnb, to rent out apartments in certain cities across Europe. And could that be in violation of the European rules? Those were the questions. At the outset, we knew absolutely nothing about Airbnb. We hadn't heard of any Airbnb lobbyists in Brussels. We knew for a fact that at that point they did not have an office, they do now. So we were actually a bit unsure whether we would find anything at all. But after a couple of months of digging, this is the image that appeared. There is not a huge army of lobbyists that work for Airbnb and similar platforms. They are actually, perhaps there are only a dozen, but they're extremely effective. They're very, very well connected. And mainly because of the vision of the European Commission in this area. This relates to something that is now called the collaborative economy. Let's not go into an academic discussion on the term, but a collaborative economy covers platforms like Airbnb, HomeAway, some would say Uber and Deliveroo, and who knows what. So all the services that are